Hello there, and welcome back to the booth here at Pro Tour Kaladesh. Marshall Sutcliffe with Luis Scott Vargas, and we're all set for our finals matchup, and it is a big one. Carlos Romao versus Shota Yasooka. Both players have already won Pro Tours in different forms. World Championship for Carlos and a Team Pro Tour for Shota, but they are looking to pick up their first regular individual Pro Tour title. Let's head down to the feature match area for the finals. Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Kaladesh. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Luis Scott Vargas, and it is time for the finals. We have two heavyweights of the game ready to battle it out in what is going to be a control mirror, though, with two different decks. Our first competitor, Shota Yasooka from Japan, the Hall of Famer. He is a Pro Tour champion. He won PT Charleston in 2006 alongside two of his countrymen. He's playing Grixis Control. On the other side of the table, we have Carlos Romao, the world champion from 2002, and also the GP Atlanta champion. That was just a week ago. He's been on a real run lately. He's playing Jeskai Control. And of note here, Luis, Shota's on the draw.
Yeah, and you know, that is
interesting. He chose to be on the draw.
One is no one ever chooses to be on the draw and construct. It's incredibly rare.
Right.
The other is that You have to be very confident in your decision to do that. The last person I can remember choosing to start on the draw was actually Guillaume Wafotapa, another Hall of Famer and another Control mastermind.
So we'll see if it pays off for Shota. Being on the draw in Constructed.
It's actually going to work out pretty well, I think. Both players are just going to go, you know, basically draw, go, play their draw card, play their land, and say go for much of the game. And actually, Carlos kept a landlight hand with a lot of expensive cards. If him being on the play means that he's less likely to hit land number four, Shota's plan worked out beautifully. And look, Carlos just missed a land drop.
Wow, here we go. This could be it for Shota Yasooka to take control of the early stage of the game. He's going to fire off and anticipate. But it looks like the combination of Ether Hub plus Harness Lightning is going to be enough to take down Thing in the Ice.
And if Carlos wasn't able to kill that Thing in the Ice, that would have put a ton of pressure on him, especially since he's currently lacking white mana now that he used up his energy from the Ether Hub. But even with killing that, Shota still has Anticipate, still has Painful Truths, and Carlos still doesn't have a fourth land.
Okay, Shota's going to go for Painful Truths, very powerful against Carlos' deck here, as he does have a lot of life total to play with for the majority of the game.
Yeah, that's not actually painful and definitely the truth here. This is the exact card you want in the control mirror.
In fact, he's actually gone to discard now. He's got so many cards in his hand. It's going to be Radiant Flames, another card doesn't really do much against Carlos, so he's just going to discard that anyway.
One of the features of the control mirror, which is what we have here, is that both players are going to have a fair amount of kind of dead removal spells in their main deck. So a lot of the edges to be gained or lost in game one especially is who's more heavy on the reactive cards. Like if you're Shota and you draw all your Radiant Flames and Galvanic Bombardments, you're in trouble. If you draw all your Painful Truths and counterspells, then you're in great shape.
Another Thing in the Ice here for Shota to replace the prior one. He continues to hit his land drops as well. And he's actually going to go for Transgress the Mind. He's going to see a lot of Glimmer. Or maybe not. It looks like Void Shatter's just going
to Carlos pretty much forced to Void Shatter that because Shota could have just taken it. And Carlos had nothing to do with his mana anyway. We're going to see a lot of main phasing here, by the way, as both players, A, want to play against counterspells, and B, want to play card draw on their turn so that they don't miss land drops.
It was a pretty good one there for Carlos. He saw a land and a Torrential Gearhulk. The Gearhulk really a key piece of the puzzle for Carlos Romao. How does it change here now? We saw it against the aggro decks where he was able to flash it in, block, flash back a removal spell, but I'm assuming it plays out differently in a control mirror.
Gearhulk is mainly going to want to hit either Glimmer of Genius or Void Shatter in this control mirror.
Okay.
I mean, sometimes you'll be forced to do something else, but those are the main targets. And you know that your Gearhulks are not going to survive all that often because Shota's going to have cards like Unlicensed Disintegration sitting in his hand. Maybe he has double Galvanic Bombardment or you know, already maybe already used one up previously or discarded one previously. And in general, I think that despite Carlos being happy to see Gearhulks in general, he shipped that one to the bottom because he wanted to make sure he hit a sixth land, and he had a really good six drop there.
He's got one in his hand right now. And this is going to be Quarantine Field, which was really, really powerful. This is a big swing for Carlos. After having missed a land drop, he's really gotten back on the board nicely, taking down that Jace Unraveler of Secrets. That was going to do a lot of work, maybe even working its way up to an ultimate, but instead it's going to get hidden away under that Quarantine Field. And since Shota's on Grixis colors, he's going to have a pretty difficult time touching an enchantment. You don't do that particularly well.
Of note, we did see Shota Ultimate Jace in one of the final rounds of Swiss.
You got your wish.
I did.
Kind of. In the meantime, again, one of the key cards for the matchup is Glimmer of Genius. We're going to see this card hit the stack many, many times and maybe even some fights over it throughout the course of this five-game match. The first two games are going to be played without sideboards, and then any games after that will have sideboards in play.
Shota shipping Unlicensed Disintegration to the bottom because despite it being effective at killing Torrential Gearhulk, that is not really what this fight is going to be about. You're going to pick up enough removal that can kill Gearhulk in general. I mean, sometimes you might end up in a spot where you need it, but there are a lot more action cards Shota would rather see.
Well, there's the third time Shota's running a Thing in the Ice out there.
We'll see if Thing 3 sticks because it does take a little bit to tick down, so Carlos has some time to deal with it.
This is the second Glimmer of Genius now for Carlos Romao. And by the way, he has a backup, another one in his hand.
I'll get a die for counters on that Thing of the Ice, I'm sure, soon here. Okay, we'll stop. Of note also, Shota has two Glimmer of Genius in his deck. Carlos has four.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the bigger card drawing spells that can be played at instant speed. So despite the fact that Shota has three Painful Truths, so has more overall card draw, Painful Truths is a sorcery, and these players, once it gets to a stage where they both have mana up, it's hard to tap out. Though we've seen this kind of funny counterplay over the last couple of turns where both players are tapping out, because once one player taps out, the next player's like,
funny,
all right, well,
it?
I'm going to tap out then because you're tapped out, and it just keeps going back and forth. Carlos here broke serve, has all his lands untapped. It makes it a little bit riskier for Shota to commit to the board here.
Yeah, so he's just going to keep moving things forward in a more incremental way, this time with an anticipate. That's going to tick down Thing in the Ice to three counters. Shota finds an island with anticipate, doesn't even bother shuffling it into his hand, just plays it.
You know, actually from both players the whole tournament, they just flip the cards into play. And, you know, they're both control gurus, so maybe that's all part of the pattern.
So what we have here is a Harness Lightning targeting Thing in the Ice. He is going to need to use up four energy to make sure that it dies, but Carlos has plenty to spare. So that's the third time that a Thing in the Ice has started getting thawed out, but then either got bolted or under the quarantine field, as Shota has yet to be able to transform one.
Well, despite Carlos missing his fourth land drop, you know, many, many turns ago, both players have continued to develop their mana. Carlos actually land ahead of Shota at this point, but both have enough lands in play that they can cast, you know, they can cast any spell in their deck, and not quite to the point where they're casting Torrential Gearhulk with counterspell backup, but we're getting close to that, and that's where we're going to see the real fight start.
How do these games end?
Usually it's going to be Torrential Gearhulk, but that's almost more a symptom of winning than the actual path to victory. Basically, if one player can resolve Gearhulk into Glimmer of Genius or Gearhulk into Void Shatter, it indicates that the other player doesn't have a counterspell, doesn't have a way to stop it. And especially in game one, that is going to put the player resolving Gearhulk significantly ahead. A wrinkle in that, though, is that both players also have all these dead removal spells. You see Shota with Harness Lightning, Galvanic Bombardment, Radiant Flames. You're going to be able to use kind of these throwaway cards as a way to stop the opposing 5/6.
Even if you have to pile a couple of them together, you don't mind.
It's funny that if you combine Harness Lightning and Radiant Flames to kill Torrential Gearhulk, you somehow feel like you got the better deal because those cards are just rotting in your hand.
That's really funny. Cause, you know, normally when we think of getting two for one is a pretty bad thing, but...
And it's going to be very tricky to figure out exactly who's ahead at any given time because this is a true control-on-control matchup. The cards on the board don't tell the full story. So we're going to do our best to try to evaluate where we're at in the particular play and counterplay of the game.
And where we're at here is Torrential Gearhulk has just resolved for Carlos Romao, and he's replayed one of his Glimmer Geniuses.
Yeah, and that's huge. That's a big step because we don't see.
And right on time, by the way, Luis, we see a Galvanic Bombardment teaming up with a Harness Lightning to take down the Gearhulk itself.
This is not a control matchup that features a card like Sphinx's Revelation. If you remember, you know, the premier control deck from a couple years ago where a player will draw 10 cards and that's how you can just tell that they've won the game. We've got a lot of Scry 2, Draw 2s and Torrential Gearhulks that, you know, provide you with incremental advantage, not this, like, overwhelming avalanche. So even though Carlos did resolve Glimmer and Gearhulk, that does put him ahead. I think Carlos is in good shape here. It is gonna be, you know, something that Shota can come back from, especially if Shota draws more cards like the Void Chatter he just drew.
Yeah, he just drew that Void Chatter, then immediately passed the turn back. These players both play pretty quickly, which is nice. Oh, he drew his Mountain of Shame.
Yeah. Again, Shota being a control guru here, that mountain, it makes me slightly unhappy. But Carlos does have an Avacyn now, and that Avacyn is going to represent a pretty decent threat if Shota runs out of removal. And you see Shota's sitting here discarding Radiant Flame.
Yeah.
While Carlos discards Fumigates. So it's actually kind of interesting, too. The order in which you draw your lands can be critical in matchups like this. Because, look, both players are discarding the hand size right now. If you drew a land instead of a spell, you'd play a land and not have to discard and be a land ahead. So hitting your land pockets at the right time actually makes a huge impact because instead of discarding cards, which you could play later, like that Blessed Alliance that Carlos discarded, that could have killed a Gearhulk later or a Wandering Fumeral. That is very, very relevant.
Here's Archangel Avacyn now for Carlos Romao. And Yasooka is just going to use Harness Lightning to kill it with the ability still on the stack. So Archangel Avacyn did resolve, but he had a burn spell in hand to use, and he decided to use it. You can see Painful Truths in hand for Shota, but he knows he's just going to end up discarding those cards anyway.
And two interesting things about that last turn. One is that Shota chose not to cast Painful Truths. He instead went to go discard to hand size.
Which he just did again, by the way.
He did Galvanic Bombardment, hitting the bin. The second is that because Carlos cast Archangel Avacyn, Shota didn't have to discard. He got to use his Harness Lightning instead. So Shota had to be happy about that exchange.
Yeah, nobody wants to be the first one to cast a spell here into the other's plays. A couple of lands back-to-back for Yasooka. Not too bad, though.
Oh, no. He really is happy to draw those lands because instead of discarding, he's building up his mana base. Both players are setting up to have a pretty big fight. Like, if we took a look at Shota's hand here, he's got double Torrential Gearhulk. He's got Ceremonious Rejection, Negate, double Void Shatter. That's four counterspells and 2 6-mana flash cards. So he wants as many lands in play as possible. If he draws spells, even good ones, he has to discard here.
By the way, we have hit already the stage of the control mirror. The players are now counting each other's libraries. 24. Okay. Shota's got 22 cards in his library.
You gotta love it.
Looks like Carlos has somewhere around 30. About 29. So
it might actually come to that because
we're not there yet, but
I would not expect that to happen in post sideboard games, but in pre-board games like we're in now and will be for game two, both players have more removal than the opposing player has threats. And that is something that can come up. Wandering Fumeral kind of critical here.
Yeah.
Because it is a way to potentially finish the game, and Shota only has 2, whereas Carlos has 4.
Trade a few lands for a few of those removal spells. Maybe be able to stick a threat later in the game or protect it.
All right, looks like we're gonna start the cascade. Anticipate and Glimmer of Genius are the main targets for Shota at the end of Carlos's turn here.
And it is going to be Glimmer of Genius here from Shota. Well, the Galvanic Bombardment doesn't look great. I believe he's got a Painful Truth hiding behind that, which he already has one in his hand as well.
It's funny because as desirable as Painful Truth is, when you are actually somewhat concerned about decking. You may just not want it.
He didn't want it. He put it on the bottom of his library. I think that should be exiled there.
Yes, that Glimmer of Genius, because it got cast via Torrential Gearhulk. Mm-hmm. So we're going to see some fights over what takes out this Torrential Gearhulk. I mean, Shota may let the first Gearhulk just die, because that's well within his range of, you know, he attacks, Carlos casts Immolating Glare, and he just lets the Gearhulk die. But at some point, because Shota has fewer cards in his deck, he's going to need to fight over removal spells and try to force through a Fumarole or a Gearhulk or the last thing in the ice. There's one of those remaining.
Yeah, remember, this is the same game that Shota tried to get that thing in the ice rolling three different times, but Carlos stopped him each time. And there's a Glimmer of Genius from Romao.
And it's possible Shota also didn't want to attack with Torrential Gearhulk until he's ready to battle over Immolating Glare or Blessed Alliance, because he knows... Well, I guess the Blessed Alliance has been discarded, but there's still three Immolating Glares left in deck, and both players are well aware of the opposing deck list at this point. Carlos has stacked up 10 energy, by the way. So his Harness Lightnings are straight-up removal spells. They can take down Torrential Gearhulk.
Yeah, speaking of, there's a Harness Lightning from Romao. He's targeting the Gearhulk. And he's kind of picking a fight with Shota. Shota has to decide, do I just want to let this one go? Or is this the time that I want to start firing off negates and void shatters to try to protect it? It's going to certainly take stage one. And Carlos isn't going to fight him over it either.
Yeah, especially since Carlos still has that Immolating Glare in hand. I think he's not quite as worried.
Land go from Carlos Romao, who drew an anticipate for his turn. That Gearhulk still has not hit the red zone. And it won't this time either. Shota played a land and pass a turn back.
Kind of funny that part of Shota's mana base involves four copies of Evolving Wilds, so he gets to, you know, go search for a basic with it. And that's because he built a mana base that, around Smoldering Marsh and Sunken Hollow, so it makes sense. But the downside of that is that his Evolving Wilds thin out his deck a little bit, and that's part of the reason that that Carlos may be ahead on cards
that's
in deck.
That's funny. Here's Anticipate now from Carlos Romao. By the way, Carlos is now actively tracking number of cards in library for each player. He certainly feels like that's going to be an important part of the puzzle here for game one.
And I will repeat that post-board games are way less likely to come down to this, as both players take out removal spells, add in more counter spells, and potentially more ways to close out the game. But it is relevant in game one when both players are sitting on tons of ways to kill these Torrential Gearhulks and Wandering Fumaroles that, you know, largely are the way that these decks win games. We've seen these decks win throughout this weekend with just a couple Gearhulk hits. You know, it's trivial. You kill all their creatures, then you attack them. Well, they're playing against a matchup where the deck opposing deck is just full of removal spells.
I can tell you that Shota Yasooka has about 17 cards left in his library. Carlos has about 22, 23. He's about five cards ahead of him at this point as far as cards to spare. And normally that wouldn't be a good thing, but here it does look actually like one.
And in game one, Shota has five counter spells, six if you count Ceremonious Rejection, which does count because it can target Void Shatter because it is devoid. Whereas Carlos has the three Void Shatters, two Summary Dismissals. So
yeah, he's found a use for a Fumigate here.
Yeah, Fumigate will in fact kill Torrential Gearhulk if it resolves.
Shota's consulting his graveyard.
3 points of damage have been inflicted this game. They were when Shota cast Painful Truth.
That's right. All right, so Shota is going to fight here. He's going to play Void Shatter to counter the Fumigate.
And this is why Carlos has such a huge advantage right now. Shota's trading one of the best cards in the matchup, Void Shatter, for one of the worst, Fumigate. And the reason he has to do that is because Carlos is not going to run out of cards, and Shota is. So Carlos knows he just has to sit there. He just has to make sure he doesn't die to Torrential Gearhulk. Shota, on the other hand, has to expend resources protecting Gearhulk. So what we might see this game is Carlos end up trying to kill the Gearhulk, Shota countering a bunch, Carlos eventually finding a way to kill Gearhulk and either winning just off his own Gearhulks or winning off decking if he can kill all of Shota's win conditions. So Carlos has multiple paths to victory here.
Well, Shota has multiple Gearhulks. He's casted another one here. He's left himself a Void Shatter up as well to try to protect it.
With Ceremonious Rejection also, you know, being very relevant if Carlos himself has a Void Shatter.
So summary dismissal here from Carlos is going to get Void Shattered. But wait, there's more.
Well, I think Shota might reject Carlos's next play if Carlos chooses to run Void Shatter.
This is interesting.
The thing is, at the end of all this, Carlos still has a bunch of white cards like Stasis Snare and Immolating Glare that deal with these Torrential Gearhulks. I also do very much appreciate the pace of play of these players. Even though this turn is an intricate one, overall this match has gone many, many turns at a very fast pace.
It absolutely has. You can tell by how many lands each player has in play. This one has gone on for quite a while. And yes, indeed, Carlos Romao is going to Void Shatter, and that is going to prompt Ceremonious.
So, to recap, Torrential Gearhulk is being countered by Carlos's Summary Dismissal. Shota is Void Shattering the Summary Dismissal. Carlos is Void Shattering the Void Shatter. And Ceremonious Rejection is countering Carlos's Void Shatter.
And on top of all that, there's going to be a Stasis Snare, it looks like.
And the Stasis Snare will exile the first Torrential Gearhulk.
The one that's actually on the battlefield.
The second one's still on the stack. Shota specifying Void Shatter, Exiles, Summary Dismissal, and that's relevant in case Carlos then plays a Gearhulk later.
Yep. And now, finally, at the bottom of that stack is a Torrential Gearhulk, and it does get to flash something back.
Shota choosing Anticipate, potentially because that it removes less cards from his library than Glimmer of Genius.
Draw one versus draw two. 14 cards left in library. Make that 13 for Shota Yasooka.
Yeah, and that Anticipate should be exiled. Whoop, is... Immediately a judge exiles it. There we go. Shota also, by virtue of winning that fight, does get a free reign to attack with some Wandering Fumeral. So this is 13 damage.
Whew.
Had he had another Wandering Fumeral, I guess his deck actually only plays two, so it would be difficult for him to have a third one, but that would have added up very quickly. This still does a fair amount of damage, and Shota's nearly out of counterspells at this point.
Okay, both of the Fumarils are in alongside the Gearhulk as Shota has managed to effectively tap out Carlos Romao down to just that one land, and that is a big hit. 13, like you said, Luis, is going to drop Carlos down to 7, but that last 7 may prove very difficult to get.
And, if we take a look at Shota's hand here on the screen, he's got that last Void Shatter, so he's got a piece of interaction. Glimmer of Genius could try to find something, but again, most of his counterspells are in his graveyard. Essence Extraction and Painful Choose just not really where you want to be. Flip over to Carlos's hand, and he's got Archangel Avison, which will provide a great blocker. Immolating Glare, which will take out Torrential Gearhulk. And Summary Dismissal, which will help him protect both of those attempts.
Here's Dovenbond now from Carlos Romao. He's going to plus Dovin, targeting the Gearhulk. Well,
Gearhulk becomes a 2/6 until Carlos's next turn.
But in the meantime, Shota's kind of going for it here. He's casting the Glimmer of Genius. Doesn't have a lot left in his library, but he certainly has enough to resolve this.
Carlos also, as is his tradition, seems mostly okay with letting card draw spells resolve. That was an integral part of his strategy in winning the world championships he won, as it turns out. Not great news for Shota. He just drew two red cards. Red cards are not where you want to be in game one here.
All right, well, he's really going for it now.
Well, the thing about decking is once you're already going to be decked, in this case, Shota is going to deck before Carlos, it doesn't matter that much how fast it is because Shota's not going to be constrained by number of attack steps. It's going to be if he can find all of his threats and answers before Carlos finds more answers.
So he's just going through it now.
Shota has accumulated a lot of cards, but as is expected in game one, a lot of these cards are removal spells, which are not incredibly relevant, though. Unlicensed Disintegration is a good counter to Avacyn.
Well, now that Shota's decided to start casting his card draw spells, the difference between library sizes is significant. It's 8 cards left in Shota Yasooka's library. Carlos Romao is on 20. It is a race against time for Shota Yasooka here in game one of our finals. He needs to get that last 7 points of damage in through Carlos Romao's defenses before he runs out of cards in library and gets decked.
Now, this rules might wander over here.
Indeed. He's going to fire up both of them, attack with everything. Looks like he's going to ignore Dovinbon.
So, technically lethal, this is 10 points of damage, assuming Shota switches the power and toughness on the two fumaroles.
Gearhulk's still on 4, 8, 10 total?
Yeah, 10 okay. total. It's a 2-6 right now.
Right. So,
but it is going to prompt Carlos to do something here.
Let's see what he does. Well, first things first, he's got his own fumarole down there. He's also got an Archangel Avacyn in his hand, Luis, that he could fire off. He has that Immolating Glare from earlier, too.
Definitely. And actually, chat brings up a good point. Summary Dismissal, less good at protecting your own spells because it exiles everything on the stack. It's non-discriminatory. Mm. Very good at stopping opposing threats. So if Shota were to counter this Avacyn, Carlos is unlikely to cast Summary Dismissal in response. Mm-hmm. But because Shota has Galvanic Born and Unlicensed Disintegration, it's actually going to be tough for Carlos to get this Avacyn to work. Carlos also has to balance whether he's able to activate Fumarole here. So let's see. Carlos activates Fumarole. He can still cast Immolating Glare. Shota still has Void Shatter. Shota also has Unlicensed Disintegration, which will deal 3 damage because that Torrential Gearhulk fuels the artifact count. So, currently, Avacyn is in play. Her Indestructible triggers on the stack. Okay. Galvanic Bombardment is targeting Avacyn to deal 4 to it. Carlos almost cast Summary Dismissal to counter the Bombardment, but I think at the last moment realized that that would also counter the Avacyn Indestructible trigger, making her a much less effective of a blocker. Again, Summary Dismissal, a very, very strange card here.
So, there's Summary Dismissal. Exile all other spells and counter all abilities. And there it is, Unlicensed Disintegration from Shota. He even has an artifact.
So that will deal 3 damage, taking Carlos to 4. Carlos can Immolate and Glare one of the Wandering Fumaroles. The other Wandering Fumarole deals 4, even without the Trench or Gearhulk.
That's so lethal.
Because what Carlos could do is he could Immolate and Glare the Gearhulk. That would make it so Shota doesn't have an artifact in play. But then the two Wandering Fumaroles would deal 8 damage total. So I think Shota's actually able to pull this out.
He did. Shota Yasooka won game one here. Oh, man. Even for him, he has to crack a smile there. Yeah. That game went very deep.
I mean, he knows he earned it.
Wow. He certainly did. And that is just game one of our finals here. We've got a lot more Magic to bring you. We'll be back right after these messages.
Put what you've learned from watching the Pro Tour into action next weekend at Game Day. Test your skills and your new standard deck at a store near you. Top finishers are awarded special game day prizes, including full art premium promo cards and a champion playmat for the winner.
Test drive the top standard decks from this Pro Tour in the Pro Tour Gauntlet beginning this Wednesday on Magic Online. For more information, visit mtgo.com.
And welcome back to the feature match area here at Pro Tour Kaladesh. Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Luis Scott Vargas. You take a look at that trophy over there. I can tell you, you know, Shota already has a little placard on that trophy. All of the Pro Tour champions are on there, including him. He won a Pro Tour Charleston in 2006. It was a team Pro Tour, and so he has his name on there. Now, Carlos doesn't, even though he is a Pro Tour champion. He won Worlds in 2002. That's actually a World Championship, which goes on the World Championship trophy, which also has a similar setup where each of the World Champions gets their plaque on there in perpetuity. And but Carlos is looking to have his name on as many of these things as he can possibly get, and maybe twice for Shota.
It's good to have your name on trophies. Knowing no other information, I would say it's a positive. If your name is on a trophy, you did something.
You did something right.
And in this case, you did a lot. I mean, winning a Pro Tour, winning Worlds, these are real accomplishments.
Yeah, big-time accomplishments for Carlos Romao from Brazil. Let's take a look at Unlicensed Disintegration from Kaladesh. As you know, not a card I would have highlighted for this particular matchup, but there it was. It was a big deal in that last turn sequence.
Yeah, the biggest question with this is who licensed this disintegration. I'm surprised it's actually not on the slide, but this part has proven very effective for Shota Yasooka throughout this tournament. He has the bare minimum artifacts in his deck. He's got Torrential Gearhulk, sometimes a clue token from his opponent's Declaration in Stone, but it's still an unconditional removal spell. It's 3 mana to kill any creature, which his control deck's very happy to play.
Yeah, reminds you of Terminate. Costs a little more, has a little upside on the sides. I really am curious about who the licensing body for these disintegrations is.
I would assume the consulate as a level 5 flavor judge.
Fair enough. All right, looks like the players are ready. Let's get back down to business here in the finals. Shota Yasooka up a game over Carlos Romao in this control mirror. Now, again, I want to remind you that this is a pre-sideboarded game. We have not entered the sideboard phase yet. That will happen next game. So we are going to see a similar playout with a lot of extra removal spells that they don't need.
And notice who went first. It was Shota Yasooka, the winner of game 1. So Carlos
stole his thunder there, huh?
Yeah, he likes Shota's technology of choosing to draw first. And I think it makes a lot of sense. I mean, we saw how that game went. That is going to be typical of game 1s.
This is just too cool. The real question is, would Carlos have chosen that head?
Yeah, I was wondering the exact same thing.
Not chosen in the first game. He certainly was convinced. So
neither player has missed a land drop yet, which is pretty critical in this like developing part of the game. Once your opponent misses a land drop, you sense weakness and you know that you're able to press the advantage a little bit. Shota ended up winning a very long game after Carlos missed his fourth
about
land
25
drop.
Turns after he missed a land drop.
And it's not clear that missing the land drop was exactly the reason Shota won. But remember earlier, Carlos discarded a Blessed Alliance. Had he had that Blessed Alliance at some point in that game, he may have been able to utilize it to survive.
That's insane.
Both players also trading off Glimmers of Genius here, and because they have so few counters and those counters are so precious in game 1, I'm not surprised that neither player chose to counter the opposing Glimmer of Genius.
One thing we haven't seen from Shota yet that we saw a lot of in that first game, Thing in the Ice.
Yeah. Shota hasn't seen one of those yet. He's going to play Thing in the Ice early. Kind of the nature of the card is you have to play it early to start triggering off spells, so it's not very easy to just keep that in your hand and not play it.
Just must not have drawn any yet. Romao actually has run out of lands here, though. He didn't draw one either.
He did discard Radiant Flames last turn because he cast Glimmer end of turn.
Okay, well, now he found one off of the Glimmer. He bottomed both cards with the Scribe but found a Plains.
Well, he has a Fumeral Heightened over there. So Romao hasn't missed a land drop yet.
No, he hasn't missed one, but he was out coming into this turn.
Oh, yeah, definitely. He was, and it's the sort of thing where he's going to Glimmer and keep lands on top if he sees them. So.
Yeah. All right. He plays an Aether Hub here.
One disadvantage to...
Discard?
To being on the draw here as Carlos has... chosen to be, is that you do have to discard after your glimmers, whereas Shota being on the play didn't have to discard after casting a glimmer.
Yeah, and we saw that in game one. Shota was discarding to hand size as well.
Yeah, Shota may discard again. He watched his Painful Truths resolves.
Indeed. Is this the kind of fight that Carlos can pick with Shota, or does he just have to let him see all these cards?
It's tricky. My inclination in general is to say that card draw is okay here because there's so few cards that unconditionally counter spells, and both players have more card draw than you can realistically hope to stop, especially since they're not clocking the opponent. On the other hand, drawing three cards is a pretty big advantage.
Look at this. Carlos Romao just running out the Torrential Gear Hulk here. He's got a Glimmer of Genius in his graveyard. In fact, he has two of them.
It's actually
and it's resolving.
Out. Shota doesn't have a Void Shatter. So there's no way for him to avoid having that Gear Hulk hit the board.
Yeah, did you hear that? I heard Shota kind of go, uh-oh, this is not great. Carlos just kind of went for it, thought, okay, well, this probably is going to get countered, and it didn't. And he's going to have to fire two burn spells at the Gear Hulk there to take it down to make sure that Shota doesn't start getting big chunks of his life total taken out.
And a pretty good exchange for Shota there. I mean,
and for Carlos.
But yeah, Carlos is happy that he got to resolve a glimmer, but Shota's happy he got to kill a Torrential Gear Hulk. I think in general, if you can use your removal spells on Gear Hulks, you're going to be pretty happy.
I mean, it was a 4-for-1 for Carlos, right?
Not bad. That is not bad. You know, looking back on game one, one of the reasons Shota won, he didn't attack with Gear Hulk many turns in a row to never give Carlos the opportunity to cast Immolating
Glimmer. Yeah, that's right. That one was just sitting there waiting in the wings that whole time.
So very,
God,
very
Shota's
smart.
Shota's so good. Here's Dovenbond now for Carlos Romao. This could be interesting as well.
Dovenbond's ultimate, your opponents can't untap more than two permanents during their untap step. Essentially Static Orb, for those who remember that card. It's actually a masterpiece you can find in Kaladesh packs. If you can get up to ultimate, Dovenbond is a pretty big threat, but Wandering Fumarole does a pretty good job of chipping away at Dovenbond, and if Carlos is taking it up, then he's not drawing extra cards, which he elected to do.
He's going to need a removal spell for the Wandering Fumarole here as Shota is attacking Dovenbond with it, and he is, in fact, going to switch his power and toughness. So Harness Lightning is going to be met with Negate, and that means that Dovenbond is going to die.
He's going to hit the Dovenbin there.
Indeed. So that worked out for Shota pretty well. He was able to utilize one of his creature lands.
He traded a Negate for a Harness Lightning and a Dovenbond. Carlos also drew an extra card. The other hand, Carlos discarded a hand size, so keeping track of who's up exactly which, how many cards is going to be tricky.
It's getting a little tricky here.
But it's your job, so you're going to manage.
I'll figure it out. Don't worry.
Also of note, Shota drew both of his Wandering Fumarole last game, and, you know, that was critical. Shota's playing two, Carlos is playing four, and having both of them in play was very, very important for Shota.
Bottom for Carlos Romao. Lots of Glimmer of Genius being cast by Carlos this game.
Yeah, he has cast
four?
Three.
Well, he cast, recast, and then cast two other ones. So four have resolved for Carlos Romao.
Yes, I see two in his graveyard plus the Dovenbond and an Anticipate. I think he's just gone through a ton of cards here.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Shota has drawn fewer cards. Still hasn't missed any lands. He has 10 lands in play to Carlos's 9. Carlos is going to play his 10th. No, Carlos has to discard.
Okay, that could get interesting. There's that Unlicensed Disintegration. And here we go. Once again, Carlos Romao with the Gear Hulk. And this is yet another Glimmer of Genius being flashed back by the Gear Hulk. It's going to join the other one that's already in the exile pile there.
How many times do you have to show Glimmer of Genius before you just are declared a genius? Like eventually, they skip the preamble, right?
There's a lot of glimmering happening for Carlos Romao.
Shota's been on kind of the bad side of his deck in terms of he hasn't drawn very many counterspells or glimmers, so he's sitting there on a lot of removal. He has a Jace Unraveler of Secrets, which, powerful card, but doesn't play all that well against instant speed cards like Torrential Gear Hulk.
And once again, Shota is just going to utilize multiple burn spells. Well, it looks like Carlos is actually going to stop this one. He let the Galvanic Bombardment happen, but then countered the second one. And it looks like Shota has plenty to go. You mentioned it. They're just overloaded with removal spells in this matchup. He was able to fire three of them off that turn to kill the Giro.
Oh, that was a fantastic exchange for Shota. He's down a card, right? He spent Harness the Lightning, Galvanic Bombardment, and Essence Extraction to deal with Torrential, Gearhulk, and Void Shatter. But the quality of the two blue cards he dealt with is so much higher than the black and red cards that he had to expend.
Yeah, Harness Lightning, Galvanic Bombardment, and Essence Extraction are cards that he doesn't want anyway. And he just traded them for the really good unconditional counter spell from his opponent, Void Shatter, plus his main threat with the Gearhulk. Pretty impressive. Funny how those values change.
Also note how Shota led with the two non-life gain spells. So at the end of it, the Essence Extraction did resolve. So he gained three life. He had led with that first or second. Carlos may have countered that one. He could have led with it first as well. But either one, he, you know, as long as it's not the middle card, Essence Extraction is the highest probability of resolving. And that extra three life could add up.
Here's Dovin Bon. Number two here for Carlos Romao. He is going to minus, find himself a Void Shatter and a couple of life.
Well, things are looking up for Carlos here. I think Shota may be forced to go for a Jace pretty soon here since he doesn't have a lot else going on, and Carlos does have the Planeswalker in play.
You weren't kidding. He put it on the stack right away, and that freshly drawn Void Shatter from Romao is going to hit it, but Ceremonious Rejection finds one of the few targets that it actually has here, and there's one more Void Shatter in hand for Carlos Romao. Is he forced to fire that off? Let's find out. He does not want to be facing down a Jace Unraveler of Secrets. That's a steady stream of cards and a relevant ultimate.
One of the problems with letting Jace resolve is Jace has such a high loyalty and Shota's likely to keep ticking it up that Carlos would have a really tough time dealing with it.
Mm-hmm. And so he does decide that he needs to counter it. Shota doesn't have anything amazing to follow up, just Thing in the Ice, but that could be a potential source of damage and annoyance for Carlos Romao and any future Gearhulks that Shota draws now. You know, Carlos is pretty well spent out on relevant cards for this matchup. You can take a look at his hand, and it doesn't look great. Well, he just drew a Summary Dismissal. I guess that does help.
Yeah, the double Immolating Glare will help protect Dovin Bon if it comes down to that. Yeah, but, yeah, Summary Dismissal was a pretty critical draw.
Yeah, before that, his hand was Archangel Avacyn, a pair of Immolating Glare, and a Fumigate. He just drew another Summary Dismissal off the top of the library.
We saw Summary Dismissal do a lot of work against Matnass and Emrakul, the Promised End, earlier. Here it's got a slightly different use, but still a counterspell. The fact that it counters all things, you know, big and small, is very, very relevant here.
Interestingly, Dovin Bon has ticked up the last two turns. Is he marching towards an ultimate here?
I could definitely see that happening. Both players are very much, you know, needing to invest tons of mana into their big plays, like Torrential Gearhulk, like Glimmer of Genius, various counter wars. I wouldn't be surprised if Carlos has a new win condition, which is just ultimate Dovin Bon. Then anytime he gets in a fight, Shota takes four turns to untap all his lands. Like, you can't play a long game against a Dovin Bon ultimate very easily.
This could be really sweet. Carlos is getting pretty close as well. He's at six loyalty on Dovin Bon. Dovin Bon will ultimate at seven.
I really hope that they have a masterpiece static orb ready to go for the emblem here.
No, it's an emblem. Yes. See, you can interact with a static orb, but this emblem is just going to be there to stay.
Well, Shota did find a Painful Truths there, and now he's in a position where he's definitely going to want to fire it off. He's going to tick down Thing in the Ice and hopefully find him the kind of disruption he needs to deal with that Dovin Bon.
Okay, so Thing in the Ice is down to just the one counter, and there's Painful Truths on the stack for Shota.
Carlos not super worried about this Thing in the Ice. It'll flip into Awoken Horror, likely this turn, but Carlos has double Immolating Glare, so even if Shota does do that, it's going to be hard for him to actually connect with it. And Shota just drew a bunch of lands and another Thing in the Ice, so Shota does not have the combination of cards he's looking for, especially in this game one, multiple copies of Radiant Flames.
Now, one interesting thing is, what happens if you Summary Dismissal the Thing in the Ice trigger?
The last counter, well, what happens is if you remove the last counter and then it triggers and then you dismissal that, it'll be 0-4 in play without any counter.
And it can't transform at that point, realistically. Right?
Unless you found a way to put a counter back.
Put an ice counter back on it. That's kind of cool. though I don't think that that's really the right play here for Carlos, as he does have those two immolating glares and really actually just wants to find a target for them.
Right. The double immolating glare makes that all unlikely to come up, but a kind of interesting one.
Okay, Dovin Bond's at 7. Are we going to see an ultimate?
I think we have a very good chance of that, given Carlos's hand. I mean, double Immolating Glare, Stasis Snare, double Summary Dismissal, Archangel Avacyn. He can't cast all of these in the same turn, but he's going to be able to play enough of these cards that he should be able to stop Shota from getting through here. Oh, it looks like the thing, the removing the last counter is the same trigger. So you could actually just stop the last counter from being removed, but then it'll just stay in play with one counter.
Okay.
Stasis Snare, also an effective answer to that, by the way.
Yeah, and it also fills that same category as the Immolating Glares and cards that don't have a whole lot else going on anyway. Now, the question here is, he can ultimate right now. Does he just slam it, or does he wait another turn? It doesn't look like there's a big risk there.
I like the idea of using the ultimate right now, but Carlos's hand is pretty safe. So I don't think that he's at much risk. It's time for a library count. That's what it's time for. Basically, if his library is at a point where he's going to win the decking war, then he's less likely to need a win condition.
24 cards for Shota, 23 for Carlos.
The funny thing about all the card draw in both of these decks is...
Already did it!
There's not targeted card draw. All right.
Yeah, no, there's not. So we have Dovin Bond ultimate... And now Shota is going to have to work through this rather awkward scenario where he only gets to untap two permanents. Now, the fact that he plays relatively few creatures means that it's basically lands we're talking about here, but you've seen how these fights go where it'll be like Gearhulk, counter it, and it's just going to leave Shota tapped out for multiple turns. And he gets to untap two. By the way, you did see a thing in the ice go on the stack, but Carlos Romao is having none of it. He actually played the summary dismissal just on that. And by the way, here's another one, which he does not elect to counter.
Carlos up to 13 energy.
Yeah, and he's tapped out our dice here, too. That's a 12-sider, so I'll have to find another one.
So Carlos on multiple ways to kill thing in the ice, Archangel Avacyn. And a Fumigate, which actually he could use at some point if he found it necessary.
Now, what's the Archangel Avacyn's role here? He's had that in his hand forever. He's had tons of mana, and he has not decided to cast it.
Eventually, he may want to start attacking with Archangel Avacyn, but I think that he wants to wait to try to protect her. She does die to many of the cards in Shota's deck. Galvanic Bombardment, once two have been played, deals 4. Unlicensed Disintegration, Harness Lightning, because both players end up having a bunch of energy sitting around. Also, Shota has drawn a pair of Void Shatters here, so Shota's now the one who's ahead on counterspells.
No threat from him, but Thing in the Ice is on the battlefield.
You know, Carlos does not have the right cards to pressure Shota into tapping out, so this Dovin Bond ultimate so far has actually done nothing.
No, it hasn't done anything at the moment.
In the last 7 turns, Shota's had 2 permanents tapped twice. That is it.
Right.
And he's been able to untap both of them each time.
Yeah, I mean, my assumption was that they would enter into some type of fight at some point that would punish Shota, but look how much land he has now.
Yeah, Spire Bluff Canal entering plus? The battlefield tapped there.
Yeah, he's declining to sacrifice his Evolving Wilds up there as well. He's either out of basics or he just wants to keep his library count high.
Yeah, I believe it's mostly the latter, and same reason he discarded Anticipate to hand size.
Because it's close.
And
lots of lands off the top of the library here for Shota as well. He did find a Torrential Gearhulk last turn, by the way, and so did Romao. Fumigate.
Carlos casting that, figuring that, especially given that their hand sizes are creeping up, might as well try to provoke something from Shota here. Looks like Shota's kind of like, you know, nudged that negate up, kind of giving a hint as to what his Torrential Gearhulk might want. See if Carlos decides to battle over that.
Summary Dismissal is going to send it packing.
Yeah, but unfortunately for Carlos, that also sends the Fumigate into the exile zone. The Summary Dismissal goes to the graveyard, though. So not the best backup there. Shota, keeping four lands tapped, Dovin Bond emblem confirmed great.
Let's not get too ahead of ourselves here.
And the only spell Shota's played in the last like, six or so turns has been a Torrential Gearhulk, which doesn't even tick down thing on the ice. Carlos drawing a string of Wandering Fumaroles, which actually quite relevant here.
Kind of look good.
He may be able to start attacking with them at some point.
Another thing on the ice, seven cards in hand for Yasooka. He passes the turn back to Romao, who draws a land, plays a land, passes the turn back. Painful Truths for Shota.
Another reason
he's
Carlos
discard it.
May wait on Archangel Avacyn here. He could easily set up a turn where he attacks with Wandering Fumaroles.
Ooh,
Shota tries to kill Wandering Fumaroles. Archangel Avacyn saves it with the trigger, and that gets Carlos extra value.
Here's a Transgress of Mind now.
Yeah, and Carlos has a grip of cards, but the only counterspell looks like he's got is the Torrential Gearhulk in hand, so it's possible that this doesn't work out here.
Yeah, his hand actually doesn't look that great here, does it?
It's not good at closing out the game, and if the counts, if the relative counts have stayed the same, Shota should be have one more card in library than Carlos. Which means that the pressure is on Carlos to try and end this game.
Yeah, when the players count up, we'll have our floor reporter, Tim Willoughby, get an idea of what those numbers are. Here's Torrential Gearhulk from Romao. Going to prompt an immediate Void Shatter from Shota Yasooka, which resolves. But wait, there's more. Archangel Avacyn now from Romao.
And he's forced just to play it. He would much rather play it with Wandering Fumaroles attacking and being targeted by a removal spell. But the rest of his hand, Carlos just has, you know, his Fumigate, Quarantine Field, and 3 2-mana removal spells.
So he's going to take the only one he can there, the Fumigate. Going to prompt Harness Lightning to kill Thing in the Ice. So quite a lot of transaction happening here between the two players. And at the end of it, Carlos Romao has Archangel Avacyn on the battlefield.
Well,
Shota let that resolve.
Not for long, I suspect. Shota has multiple ways to kill her, including the third Galvanic Bombardment.
Wow, just the one mana to take down Archangel Avacyn. Pretty nice.
Deciding which of his two permanents to untap here.
Okay, so you can see Tim reaching in there and getting us the inside information here from the floor. We're counting libraries here, not life totals. Carlos has 8 cards left in his library. We think that Shota has 9. Tim says he does appear to have more, but he's still working on getting a count for us. Looks like I saw his hand jump in there. We don't want to disrupt the players too much, you know, by grabbing the library, but at the same time, we need to know. Yeah, it's actually 11 for Shota.
All right, so it is on Carlos to try and finish this game. He's got to start attacking one in Fumaroles. He's got to maybe use Avacyn, find another Torrential Gearhulk, and it's not going to be easy. Even that Dovin Bond emblem has not really slowed down Shota very much. He hasn't been able to get Shota into one of those massive tap-out wars where Shota taps 10 lands. So far, Shota's tapped between 0 and 4 lands per turn the last couple turns.
Ten cards in library for Shota after his draw step. And Carlos is forced to do this. He knows that if this game just continues in the same pattern, he's going to lose. So in come Wandering Fumaroles, a whole pack of them.
Well, Shota...
Can he kill them all?
If Shota didn't have Void Shatter, which you see in his hand, then this Avacyn could be potentially devastating because if Shota were to try to use a removal spell, maybe block Fumarole with Fumarole, Avacyn's indestructible trigger would be awesome. But Torrential Gearhulk plus a Void Shatter means that this turn is just... I don't think it'll work out very well for Carlos at all. Torrential Gearhulk can eat a Wandering Fumaroles. It can play a spell to eat a Wandering Fumaroles. And Shota has every reason in the world to cast Void Shatter on this Avacyn.
Interestingly, we are going to finally see Dovin Bond's emblem affect the board here in a pretty meaningful way in the next few turns, but it feels like this sequence is the really important one here. Wow. Yeah, this did not turn out well for Carlos Romao at all. In fact, he got in for zero damage and lost his Wandering Fumaroles there.
And should have maybe completely tapped out and have all his lands locked down for many more turns, but Carlos just has no way to end the game. He's now going to have seven cards left in his library as soon as he draws his card. His hand currently Quarantine Field and two Immolating Glares.
You know, he's going to run out the Quarantine Field to make sure that he doesn't get attacked back. But that's not the problem that he faces here. Two Immolating Glares and a land in hand now for Carlos Romao means that he just doesn't have anything going.
Yeah, I think he
wanted one more Fumaroll down there somewhere.
He wanted to try to get this Fumaroll in there, but Shota still has Unlicensed Disintegration in hand and has the ability to cast it. Shota can also wait a turn, take four here, fall to 13, and then be able to untap two lands in order to have Negate up to back up the Disintegration, which
That's exactly what he's going to do. Yeah, remember, there's a Dovin Bond emblem on the battlefield preventing Shota from untapping more than two permanents each turn. But it turns out when you have as many lands on the battlefield as Shota does, which is the majority of his lands, he still has quite a bit to work with here. Also, interestingly, he still has that Evolving Wilds just sitting there for the last 12
turns. It has not been evolving and is unlikely to do so. Carlos drew a card for his turn, cast Anticipate, just down another card.
He's down to five then in his library. Can he find a way to get Shota from 13 to 0 before he runs out of cards in library? First, we're going to see Wandering Fumaroll get activated. That's actually going to get hit potentially by a Harness Lightning.
Shota trying to take stock of how many counters has Carlos used, which ones are they?
Yeah, one thing to note here is that the players have had a chance to look at the deck list from their opponent. So Shota will have a very strong idea for what's left in Carlos Romao's hand plus library, especially given how few cards that actually is. It's Negate, and that's Carlos picking up his permanents.
That was his last win condition.
Because that
Carlos
was it.
Was out. He had used three Gear Hulks. He had used two Archangel Avacyns, and that was the fourth Wandering Fumaroll.
Wow. So Shota Yasooka, masterfully, I must say, is up to 2-0 against Carlos here in the finals, and if he can win one more game of these what are going to be sideboarded games, he will be our Pro Tour Kaladesh champion, adding a second championship to him. Let's take a look at our sideboards here. We want to take a look at Shota Yasooka first to see what this goes, because one of the big storylines that you and I mentioned when we first came in was that there's a ton of dead cards in both players' libraries when they start this match pre-sideboard. What can they do to shore that up here?
Well, starting from the top, Negate, Transgress the Mind are both excellent. Ceremonious Rejection looks quite good, even if it just says counter-target Void Shatter, because it's such a crucial card in the matchup. Jace and Summary Dismissal, a little more expensive, but also very viable. And lastly, even To the Slaughter, it's a card that can take out an opposing Avacyn, Gear Hulk, or Dovin Bond. So Shota has potentially up to nine cards to bring in. He could even bring in Confiscation Coup if he felt so inclined, though I think that one is much less likely to happen.
Why don't we take a look at Carlos's board?
Yeah.
Okay.
Carlos actually has some very interesting different options, which is three copies of Gideon, Ally of Zendikar. He is a very aggressive Planeswalker here that is typically quite good against control, and I think that we're going to see that come in. Spellqueller and Negate in his own Ceremonious Rejections, also cards he could bring in. And both players are sitting on so many dead removal spells game one, Radiant Flames, Fumigate in the case of Carlos, Galvanic Bombardments, that I would imagine a lot of cards are going to be coming in.
Both players are going to be scrambling to do as much as they can to get those dead cards out.
And the texture of the matchup will change significantly post-board.
By the way, you may have heard, as we were pulling away, we saw our head judge, Toby Elliott, coming down to consult the players. And what they were talking about was clearing up an issue from the prior game where a land had entered the battlefield untapped on turn four for Shota that should have been tapped. They weren't able to rewind it in real time because it took a while for the information to get to the judge. I think actually chat may have been the ones who noticed it, so thank you for helping out with that, chat.
I couldn't tell.
The resolution for that is that Shota gets a warning for the game rule violation, and we will simply move on. Now, this is, of course, the tough part for these players. You know, there's a lot of cards that they're going to want to take out for sure, but there's also a fine balance to be struck here, and they're still consulting their sideboards.
One thing that's tempting also is to take out all your removal spells, but you do want some amount of removal because if you leave yourself completely vulnerable to something like an Avacyn or a Torrential Gearhulk or even a Wandering Fumarole, you could end up dying to damage out of nowhere with a bunch of negate-type effects in your hand.
Chat's very proud of themselves, Luis.
Oh, they always are.
As well they should be. Wow, one game away from Shota Yasooka becoming a Pro Tour champion, and I got to say, I don't envy Carlos's position here of having to defeat Shota three games in a row post-sideboard in a control mirror match here to try to find that, but wow, what a story it would be if Carlos can pull that off. These have been really interactive, really deep, very long games that we've seen so far. And, you know, he has every shot to do it. It's just going to be very difficult to win three in a row against Shota Yasooka.
Yeah, and I do want to speak to the control against control dynamic for a second here because, you know, we saw Li Shi Tian play against Ben Hull in the red-white vehicles mirror match in the first round of the day here. We saw Carlos Romao play against Matt Ness in his Aetherworks combo deck in the semifinals. This is just a very different animal than those two kinds of matches, and I think it just really shows off the range of Magic that we get to see all of these within the same top eight. Like, yeah, you're not going to see red-white vehicles go to decking when it's playing against red-white vehicles. That is not going to happen. But the fact that this last game went down to decking, game one almost did, but Shota was able to pull it out, I think that's really awesome to watch. I think that there's a lot going on there that might not be readily apparent, and I think we're going to try to bring you that excitement the best we can, because when you have Shota ticking off, you know, mentally, which of Carlos's threats has he played? Which counter spells has he played? How do I play around it to exploit that information? Carlos trying to figure out, okay, I'm going to deck first. How do I close this game out? And, you know, not being able to. And we actually, in game one, saw Shota with fewer cards in the library, have to attack, was successful. Game two, we saw Carlos with fewer cards in the library, had to attack, wasn't successful. And I think that it makes for a very awesome Pro Tour Finals.
You know, one of the things that occurs to me, though, is there always comes a point in these matches where, you know, you are kind of sensing it too, right, when the players reach for their library. Like, yeah, it's about time we started checking libraries. But aren't they thinking that from the very first turn? Like, they were just kind of running out the draw spells, but at some point they go, well, maybe I should figure this out. And, you know, once Shota realized that he had his library had a few more cards in it than Carlos's, he kind of cinched in on that plan, and all of a sudden you could see every move he made was just to keep the game going longer and longer and longer. But I mean, when you open your opening hand, aren't you thinking that similar thought? Well,
so I've played this kind of matchup a lot over the course of the, you know, many years I've been playing Magic, and what happens is there's this strange inflection point where the first, you know, 10 to 12-ish turns, you can't really worry about that. You have to cast your Painful Shoes if you're going to miss your fourth land drop. You have to sack your Evolving Wilds because that's how you get your lands into play. And if you run out of cards, if you let your opponent just cast three Glimmers and you don't do anything, they're just going to bury you in threats, and they're going to be ahead of you in counters. But then once it gets to the point where it's clear both players have enough lands, where both players have 10 lands in play, where both players, you know, are a pretty high life total and have dealt with the opposing threats, then you start counting libraries. And
okay,
you can't, if you play too early for the decking game, you're going to lose to a normal game of Magic, which Shota actually ended up winning game one just via attacking and running Carlos out of cards in attrition. Carlos, you know, had more cards in his deck. Shota had all the answers he needed in hand. If you're too aggressive on card draw and eventually, you know, just keep casting Painful Truths and Glimmers, well, yeah, you might actually deck. So part of the mastery in playing this matchup is knowing when it is. And actually, speaking of which, look at this opening hand.
Yeah, it's all lands and a glimmer, it looks like.
Six lands and a glimmer. Like, you would never keep that against something like red-white vehicles. I would not be surprised if Shota snaps this off.
Yeah,
in fact,
he kept
just
it.
A desirable hand.
It just looks actually kind of good, doesn't it? And he did, in fact, keep it. So we are underway in game number three. Shota Yasooka up 2-0 over Carlos Romao from Brazil. And Carlos really needs to win this game and begin that rally back in the right direction if he is going to be the Pro Tour Kaladesh champion. Shota Yasooka just needs to win one of the next three games. And he'll have his name on that trophy, not once, but twice. Anticipate for Shota. Well, he found one of his better cards, a Void Shatter. We know he has plenty of lands. That's not what he's digging for here. There's that pesky mountain again, Luis. Yeah, you shuddered when he played it, I know.
Oh, yeah. So Carlos has Wandering Fumarole tapped here, so he's not able to play Glimmer of Genius this turn. Does have Void Shatter up, though. Take a look at Shota's hand here with...
Ooh. We may have a missed land drop here from Carlos Romao.
Uh-oh, that sets off, alarm bells for Shota. So he's going to cast his Glimmer and be happy with it, but he knows that it's on Carlos now to play spells.
Carlos does have a Glimmer of his own. He could use this opening to resolve it. Of course, he won't be able to play that land for the turn if he does. So he's actually not going to. He's still just going to pass priority back to Shota, which ends his turn and brings Shota into his.
And part of the reason Carlos may do that is that if Shota were to counter this Glimmer, Carlos would have the opportunity to resolve a Gideon. But things aren't going to work out great for Carlos here.
No, in fact, Carlos is not going to have a chance to play the Glimmer of Genius this turn because he is going to play Summary Dismissal to protect his hand. Oh, but we actually have a very early counterfight here. Transgress the Mind is going to take away the Gideon that Carlos was maybe hoping to set up.
I was about to be super impressed. I was like, wow, Shota memorized his whole hand that quick. He just immediately points to the Gideon. I love that Shota knew that he wanted to get Gideon right away because that is very clearly the most dangerous card. But if he was able to memorize those other cards in a split second, then I would just, Shota would just be on another level. Not that he isn't already.
Yeah, I was going to say, the way you talk about him... He's already on that next level. Well, it looks good news for Carlos Romao. He did find a land there. So he's up to five. He still has Archangel Avacyn in hand as well.
So I want to go back to that Void Shatter play because part of the reason that Shota would cast Void Shatter there to make sure Transgress resolves is to get the information of what's in Carlos's hand. That's so valuable going forward. Whereas normally you'd rather them tap out for a spell and you Void Shatter it to get that mana advantage. I think that Shota really just wanted to see what Carlos's hand was so that he can plan out his next, 5 to 10 turns.
The game.
Yeah.
Here's Painful Truths on the stack from Shota. Carlos Romao lets out a deep sigh. He has to really decide once again, do I want to let him just keep drawing cards? Like you said, he missed a land drop, and he runs the risk of losing a normal game of Magic, not one of these how many cards in your library, how many counterspells do you have left in your entire card pool, but instead just falling behind too quickly, and he decides, I can't let that happen. I'm going to use Summary Dismissal, and once again, Carlos misses a land drop. This could be Shota starting to work his way forward in this control mirror. Glimmer of Genius, Shota is going to allow to resolve as, he doesn't actually really have anything to say about
looking
it,
looking back
he?
At Shota's hand, I mean, he did keep six lands Glimmer of Genius, and right now his hand is all lands and an unlicensed Disintegration. So Carlos actually somewhat in the driver's seat here, even if he doesn't know it. And that's part of the advantage of keeping a six-land opening hand in the control mirror. Carlos probably just assumes Shota has two counterspells in his hand and is just waiting on them.
Mm-hmm. Not a bad draw step there from Shota. He found a Glimmer of Genius.
And if you remember in pre-board games, neither player was really aggressively countering card draw. I would expect that to change post-board. Because post-board, you have all live cards, and you're less likely to deck. So
here's a huge flurry here, Luis. Sorry to interrupt, but there's a Torrential Gearhulk on the stack, and in response, Shota has played Glimmer of Genius, looking for some way to interact with it, because currently his only way is an unlicensed Disintegration, but that would get a Glimmer of Genius on the stack for Carlos as well.
And I don't think Shota has a way to counter it.
He didn't have it. He didn't find it. So he's going to have to settle for just killing the Gearhulk to make sure that there's no threat, at least. But cards-wise, Carlos kind of makes out like a bandit here. He finds, another Torrential Gearhulk as well as Spellqueller, too. So you said it. Carlos actually in the driver's seat, and especially after that Glimmer. There's a Summary Dismissal for Shota. Says, that was just one too far away.
Well, this turn's going to be good for Shota since he drew Transgress the Mind and Painful Truths. So
okay.
To kick things off with Transgress, either it gets countered or it doesn't, but he gets to at the very least, tap Carlos out, at best, see what's in Carlos's hand, and then if he can resolve a painful truce, then he's going to have a lot more action to utilize in the next couple turns.
Yeah. Carlos has a Void Shatter. He has 6 mana available. He's just going to go for the Torrential Gearhulk here. He has a Summary Dismissal in his graveyard.
And this is where you see the weakness of Summary Dismissal. This interaction has, I've never seen it come up this often. Shota can cast Summary Dismissal. It will counter the Gearhulk or exile it, but it'll also exile the Transgress, and that's a sick little 2-for-1 for Carlos.
Crazy. God, that's awkward for Shota, isn't it?
It really is.
It looks like he's just going to have to bite the bullet, though. He doesn't want that Gearhulk to resolve. That is a lot to deal with, and he knows he's going to get a bunch of cards this turn from this right here, Painful Truths anyway. Shuts us down to 17.
Looks like 2 lands and like a thing in the ice. We'll find out momentarily. Carlos drawing one of the cards he left in his deck, almost assuredly, Immolating Glare. Not high on the list of cards you want in this matchup.
Okay, there's Thing in the Ice from Shota. Shota's on 5 lands.
That's a...
Wow.
It's a lot of cards... Enough that Carlos is going to have to respect some of them being something like a Gearhulk or a Counterspell. But Carlos does not have excess lands. And see, this actually works to Carlos's advantage. It's kind of funny. If Carlos had 10, 11 lands in play, he might be waiting on his spells because he thinks Shota has Counterspells and he wants to maybe try to set up a better turn. Because Carlos doesn't have enough lands to deploy multiple things in the same turn all that easily, he's just going to start running them out one by one and Shota can't counter them. He doesn't have any spells. He's got all lands.
Is there, I've seen this before in control mirrors where you'll play a spell and your opponent will let it resolve and you just think to yourself, if you had a counter spell, you would have countered it and you realize the floodgates are open and you can just do whatever you want. Is there a spell like that? I mean, we know Gearhulk would fit that criteria, but like, would a Glimmer of Genius?
Gearhulk more than Glimmer.
Okay.
I don't think, if Carlos cast a Glimmer and Shota did not counter it, I doubt Carlos would immediately assume Shota's out of counterspells.
All right.
If Carlos slammed a Gearhulk and Shota just shrugged and said okay, I would be a little more inclined to be like, all right, I think you're done.
Cat's out of the bag. By the way, there's nothing better than that feeling when you're playing against a control player, when you play a card that you know they really want to counter and they don't, even though they have 4 or 5 cards in your hand. That feels nice.
For those asking about the unlicensed disintegration, Shota didn't have an artifact in play, so Carlos did not take any damage off that.
Okay, here's Archangel Avacyn. This is also in that in-between stage, right, where Shota just said, yeah, that resolved. And you saw a little pause from Carlos. I wonder if he's wondering, do you not have anything else? Because he's going to start going to work on Shota's life total with that Archangel Avacyn.
I think that it's going to be difficult for Shota to stop Avacyn. And once Carlos gets a bunch of hits in, then it becomes apparent Shota not only doesn't have an answer, but if Shota does go for something, Carlos just has plenty of ways to fight it. He's 3 counterspells. Carlos also has a backup Archangel Avacyn, which, first of all, can replace the first one. Second of all, can just be played for the indestructible trigger and just chosen to not be kept due to the legend rule. So that will give the current one indestructible until end of turn, which is a play that Carlos may make at some point here.
Archangel Avacyn is going to attack. Shota has actually found a Torrential Gearhulk, though, last turn.
Yeah, and if we take a look at what Shota has, Negate and Torrential Gearhulk and Void Shatter mean that Shota stacked up a pretty solid arsenal of cards here. So we might see a good swing. So Carlos is going to kick things off by casting Void Shatter. Shota is going to negate or Void Shatter of his own. Carlos...
Looks like it's going to be Negate...
So then Carlos can't cast Ceremonious Rejection yet, but he will cast Spellqueller if he wants to fight over this more, at which point Shota casts Void Shatter, at which point Carlos casts Ceremonious Rejection. So we'll see how this ends up playing out. Also possible Carlos wants to lean on Stasis Snare, but I think that's the sort of thing where you go to it if the rest of your plan doesn't work.
Yeah, there's the Spellqueller. Presumably... Shota is going to fire off Void Shatter. He does, and that is going to be ceremoniously rejected by Carlos. So that gets countered. That gets gobbled up by Spell Queller. That gets countered.
Thing the ice thaws a little bit.
A little bit. And that leaves Shota Yasooka with a pair of lands and nothing else, with lethal in the air. Carlos Romao takes game three, making this match 2-1. This is getting interesting. Now we've got 2-1. It's still in favor of Shota. Still a tall mountain to climb here for Carlos Romao. But, you know, I've won two matches back-to-back before. I'm sure Carlos has as well. Don't say anything.
I didn't say anything.
You were going to say something.
You know, I agree with you. I'm sure Carlos has as well.
See, I knew you were going to say something. I said don't say anything. And, yeah, but these players are very, very close. Only two games to go. Carlos has to win both of them if he's going to be our champion. Let's take a look at Archangel Avacyn here, Luis. This card ultimately was the one that did the bulk of the work on Shota's life total in that game. It happened to be the threat that stuck, but still, even in these control decks, just one of the best cards. You still see it post-sideboard even, because it's so fantastic. And, you know, normally when you look at Archangel Avacyn in a control deck, you think of it playing well against creature decks. You get to flash it in. You get to gobble up an attacker, maybe even transform Avacyn and wipe the board or whatever. But here, just a threat that you can play at instant speed. Really good.
Yeah, Archangel Avacyn does a lot of work, even in a control deck. Like you said, this is not a deck that has a lot of other creatures. So we haven't seen Avacyn the Purifier emerge very often out of Carlos's deck. The front side of Avacyn, just playing as a 5-mana, 4/4 flash flyer that's indestructible, just sets up ambushes, ends up letting Carlos apply pressure without tapping out on his turn. And yeah, we've seen a lot of Avacyn played throughout her duration in Standard, and I expect to continue to see her played in a variety of different decks.
Yeah, raw power like that is hard to deny. Looks like our players didn't make too many changes there on the sideboard. They are getting shuffled up as we take a look at a little bit of a bigger picture shot of our feature match here. You know, this is normally over the course of a Pro Tour weekend, we'll have four different tables going there so that we can bounce around to the other ones. But we've only got two players left in this tournament, so they get to be front and center on our big stage there, and that is a beautiful setup. Take a look at Carlos Romao. He's from Brazil. He actually owns a card shop in Brazil. Shota from Japan. There you go. There's the trophy that they're looking to get their name added to. Although, as I mentioned before, Shota actually already has his name on that trophy, and Carlos has his name on the World Champion trophy as well. So this wouldn't be the first trophy that they've had their names on, though. Getting it on there twice is kind of cool.
Brian Kibler, one of the last additions to get his name on there twice, winning Pro Tour Hawaii in 2012.
Yeah. Yeah, he won Pro Tour Austin in 2009 originally. Your name's on there.
Yeah, so I've been told.
Only once.
Thanks to the efforts of one Hall of Famer, Gabriel Nassif. He is not on there twice.
Well, and Shota.
Shota also, as it turns out. All right, let's not make a list.
You don't want to go down this list? All right.
That's not necessary.
Fair enough.
I will say that it's been awesome seeing Carlos play and succeed at the high level again.
Yeah, I mentioned it at the onset here, Luis, but he has had one heck of a week. He started his weekend out last time winning GP Atlanta. Yeah, that was limited.
You were in the booth
for that, and
I was at home watching it.
Yeah, and, you know, and then all of a sudden he hops on an airplane, flies out here to Hawaii for the Pro Tour, does a little testing, jumps in, and now if he can win two games in a row against a Hall of Famer, well, he'll have two trophies to bring back to his shop in Brazil. He's already got one locked up.
I At some point, it becomes a logistical problem. How many trophies can you accumulate on one trip and get them all back in one piece?
It's also a long trip back to Brazil.
That it is.
Okay, we are underway in our fourth game. This could be the decider. It depends on how things go for Shota Yasooka. Or if Carlos Romao can win this game, he can force a fifth and final deciding game to see who's going to win the Pro Tour. He started off down two games and is trying to rally back. Card goes to the bottom. I believe that both players were on six cards here.
Looks like it.
Okay.
So far, we've seen players elect to draw consistently here. Mm-hmm.
Shota has a thing in the ice on turn two. This is something that Carlos is going to have to pay attention to if the game goes for a little while, as it does become a pretty scary threat. This is also actually a pretty key interaction here as well. We've got an ether hub there from Carlos, though. It doesn't look like he needs to use the counter here. Glimmer of genius.
And Carlos' hand very well set up for this matchup. Dovinbon and a pair of negates in hand. No direct answer to Thingamabob, though he is currently looking at a quarantine field, which he could keep on top if he was worried about the thing. But having a planeswalker and a couple counterspells, having a glimmer to make sure you're hitting your land drops and finding more cards, I mean, this is what Carlos wants to do.
Another Dovinbon off the top, and it looks like Carlos actually decided against keeping the quarantine field in hand.
And let's see if Carlos starts firing off negates here. Wouldn't be surprised if he does.
Yeah, he's already got two of them in his hand, a pair of Dovinbons, an island, and maybe another glimmer. Yes.
So, given that he allowed it, I would expect Carlos to be interested in casting his own glimmer and maybe trying to set up turn six, Dovinbon plus with negate backup.
He didn't fire it off there while the shields were down. He's still waiting. He has those pair of negates available.
Well, one reason to fire off Glimmer end of turn here is that I think Carlos is actually not too unhappy if Glimmer gets countered, because he already has land six, a four mana planeswalker, and a negate, and he actually even found another planeswalker there, Gideon Ally of Zendikar. Take a look at what Shota's working with here. Shota has Summary Dismissal and Void Shatter, but he can only cast one right now. So if Carlos were to go for Gideon with Negate backup, Gideon would resolve.
Wow, that seems pretty good.
The drawback to doing that from Carlos's perspective is that if he goes Gideon, Shota counters it, Carlos counters back, Thing in the Ice goes down to two counters. Shota could potentially play two spells, bounce the Gideon, Ally Knight Ally token, and attack Gideon with Awoken Horror. And that seems like it could be a little bit risky.
Yeah, that does seem like a bad ending there for Carlos Romao. So tap land here for Shota Yasooka. He's just going to pass the turn back with the Painful Truths that he drew. And we have entered the land go stage of our game here. This is pretty typical of control mirrors.
And here's where Thing the Ice is really paying dividends. Shota spent two mana on this card, and it's presenting a pretty reasonable threat. You know, given that it's going to start ticking down once the players get in a counter war. Ooh. And Carlos will have to eventually deal with it. He's got Blessed Alliance, but it's still going to be annoying to try to manage not getting hit by a 7-8 Awoken Horror. And it's already made Carlos's life more complicated because he can't as easily tap out for Planeswalkers.
Torrential Gear Hulk for Shota. Just slams it on the table. And it has resolved. It looks like Carlos, with the negate in hand, couldn't do anything about the Gear Hulk, but decided to counter the Glimmer. Are they fighting over it here?
I think so. And Shota has incentive to do so because he also has a Planeswalker in hand. He has a Jace, Unraveler of Secrets, and he has multiple expensive counterspells.
Ooh.
Let's not put that one on the field.
Not Blessed Alliance. Another negate.
We might see the rare Thing in the Ice flip return Torrential Gear Hulk play here.
Kind of actually like the sound of that.
It's highly advantageous for Shota. Oh, wow.
Ooh, he just drew Transgress the Mind off the top, Luis.
Transgress is perfect because not only does it flip Thing in the Ice and make it so Torrential Gear Hulk comes back, it also lets Shota, first of all, see what Carlos has going. Second of all, play around something like Blessed Alliance very easily.
Wow, he picks up his cards very quickly because he knows how important this could be to him winning the Pro Tour. Romao has a spell queller in his hand that he can use to counter this transgress. And he's going to. He has to protect the information in his hand, which is that he doesn't have anything. He's got a pair of Dovin Bonds, a Gideon, and a Blessed
Alliance. Three Planeswalkers and a Blessed Alliance. This is Carlos's last instant.
Now Shota has to decide if he wants to run out, well, a Planeswalker, or even if he wants, I guess he could just play another Gearhulk here, though. He doesn't really have much in the graveyard for that. First things first, though, let's attack for 7.
Oh, this is going to work out very well for Shota.
And there's Blessed Alliance. Shota gets to add to his board with Torrential Gearhulk, Flashback Negate, Carlos, and get in for 7.
Carlos now at 13. He can play 2 Planeswalkers a turn. He can play Gideon and Dovinbond, but Shota has a 7-8 and a 5-6 with Jace Unraveler of Secrets in hand and Painful Truths to refill. I think Shota's in really good shape here.
Five cards in hand for Shota Yasooka. He has put himself in a very advantageous position potentially here. Even though Carlos can cast 2 Planeswalkers, one of them is Dovinbond, relatively low impact the turn you play it. The other one is Gideon, and in a situation like this, also not that high impact.
And Carlos drew Archangel Avacyn, so he has another powerful addition to the board here, but if he doesn't play her on his turn, that then makes it so Shota can cast Void Shatter or Summary Dismissal. Shota has to know if he untaps and is in a position as good as this, he's
likely to win. It's his, yeah. Dovinbond is going to kick things off for Carlos Romao. He's going to gain 2 life and draw a card.
It's just not going to do it. It's going to provide, at best, a speed bump. At worst, just 2 life and a card per turn while Shota's attacking with 12 power worth of creatures.
So there it is, Gideon. And Shota Yasooka does get to untap with this powerful board state.
To the slaughter. So,
whoa.
Shota, let's take a look. He's no cards in his graveyard, actual none. So he's
0.
He's not very close to delirium, but
no.
To the slaughter will, I suppose Dovinbond will likely be the one jumping in front of that. But Shota also has Jace Unraveler of Secrets. He can do something like bounce Spell Queller, replay Transgress, potentially bounce the Night Token. Shota has a lot of options here. He can also just leave up his mana for 2 counter spells because he just has such a dominating board presence.
Well, he's going to threaten Gideon here, send both creatures there, and really force Carlos to either double chump block, which he definitely doesn't want to do, or let Gideon go. And he decided the latter.
Another advantage to Shota not tapping out is he could also just cast To the Slaughter at end of turn if it comes down to it.
Okay. He's going to play Jace. Are we going to see Spell Queller go back to the hand?
You want to bounce Spell Queller on a turn where you're not intending to cast another spell very soon. And Carlos, or Shota's in a spot where Carlos has enough mana that he might be able to replay Spell Queller easily. And despite Shota getting to transgress, it might be more effective to wait. On the other hand, if you do it now, Carlos can't recast it. You can just, at the very worst, transgress the Spell Queller. So that actually seems like it could be a pretty intriguing line here.
He's thinking.
One of the risks you run by waiting on the Spell Queller is if you bounce Spell Queller with mana up, Carlos can replay it, try to counter the transgress.
Yes, he is going to return Spell Queller to his hand, and that puts transgress on the stack, targeting Carlos Romao, and we get a chance, or say Shota gets a chance to see what he's working with, and you can see he's got an additional Dovinbond, he's got Glimmer, he's got Archangel Avacyn, and of course the Spell Queller that we just saw go back to his hand.
Given what Shota sees here, if he can take Spell Queller, he could then counter Avacyn, and Carlos doesn't have a way to protect her.
Oh, this is getting very close here. Shota Yasooka seizing control of this game with the interactions from last turn and now capitalizing on them this turn. That's a negate off the top for Carlos Romao.
Negate could be very impactful here if Shota assumes this Void Shatter is going to work.
And a Torrential Gearhulk off of Dovinbond. Okay,
so
that's
Carlos is going to get to fight back here.
Yeah.
Carlos has 10 lands in play, so he can play either Gearhulk or Avacyn with Negate backup. He also has, if he plays one of them now, likely if he's going to play it on his turn, it's going to be the Gearhulk because he doesn't want to lose out on the Avacyn Indestructible trigger.
He's decided just to pass back the turn, so he's not going to play it during his own turn. In the meantime, Shota's going to draw a card for the turn, immediately activate Jace as well. He put that card on the bottom and then drew. He's doing some math. First things first, let's get to attacking, he says. Not worried about Dovinbon. He's just going to attack Carlos Romao directly. And there's the Torrential Gear Hulk that Carlos had found last turn. Summary Dismissal lined up here for Shota Yasooka. He also has a Void Shatter in his hand.
And Carlos, if he negates here, Shota can Void Shatter. That'll deal 12 to Carlos, taking Carlos down to 5.
Carlos declines to negate, it looks like. Well, maybe he's rethinking it.
So one good reason not to negate from Carlos' perspective is that he can cast Glimmer this turn and set up a turn where he gets to cast Negate, because Negate only costs 2 mana, and Glimmer costs 4, so Carlos has one more turn here. He knows there's going to be another battle next turn.
Okay, there's that Glimmer. He's taking every small advantage he can, including mana efficiency here, casting a 4-mana spell, and Shota is actually considering countering this, it looks like.
And a reason for Shota to do that is that Shota's also constrained on mana, which is a funny thing to say with 9 lands in play, but Shota using a 3-mana spell here with, you know, anticipate and painful choose to find more cards next turn, it is very good for Shota to be able to get that Void Shatter out of his hand.
And he did. So here's a draw step for Carlos. These are all very important at this stage in the game. He actually found another Glimmer of Genius. Look at Romao's hand there. He's got Glimmer of Genius adding to negate Archangel Avacyn and another Dovinbon. This is getting interesting.
Hard to resist killing Jace Unraveler of Secrets with that Knight Ally token, but that means Carlos is, Carlos is on the hook to stop two threats, the 5-6 Torrential Gear Hulk and the 7-8 Awoken Horror. Dovinbon can plus one, and if Carlos does that, say -3 is on the Gear Hulk, and then he has an answer for the Awoken Horror, that would keep Carlos alive.
Yeah, as tempting as it is to get rid of Jace, he does have other pressing issues here with those two creatures. Doesn't have the luxury of doing this frivolously. He really has to decide if it's worth it, and he decides that it is.
Of note, Shota's going to have Delirium. He's got Planeswalker, Instant, and Sorcery in his graveyard, and he's got that Evolving Wilds, which he's, you know, likely to sacrifice end of turn, I'll say, which at that point to the slaughter will make Carlos sacrifice a creature and a Planeswalker, which maybe doesn't remove a blocker because Carlos can just sacrifice the tapped Knight Ally token, but still a pretty big advantage here.
Also, Shota's going to see a lot of cards next turn. He's got Anticipate and Painful Truths that you mentioned at the end of his last turn, Luis, so he's going to get to kind of churn through his library to find what he needs. And now Carlos is just going to pass the turn back.
So Carlos is at 5, plus Dondovin. Mm-hmm. He's going to play Archangel Avacyn with Negate backup. If Shota can stop those two spells, Shota will win.
Let's see if Shota can do it. He's going to get to see quite a few cards here.
Carlos does have another line, by the way. It is to activate Wandering Fumarole. But if Shota could also potentially have to navigate Wandering Fumarole plus Avacyn.
Well, that was Harness Lightning. Harness off Lightning. The top. That actually kills Avacyn.
An incredibly good draw here because, depending on how Carlos plays this, Shota may actually be able to get by all of Carlos's answers here.
Okay, here's an Anticipate looking for a Negate or a counterspell of some sort.
Shota found a Negate.
He found a Negate with that Anticipate. Shota's lining up his attack here.
And he
found two perfect cards, a spot removal spell for Avacyn and a Negate as well.
And you might as well send Torrential Gearhulk at Dovinbon, is maybe what Shota's thinking. Because
both at you. Here's Archangel Avacyn. There will be a trigger on the stack here. Carlos Romao's just figuring out which lands he wants to tap.
This is the best part of playing Magic for Shota Yasooka. He can just taste
waiting. He's so close to that trophy. Okay, trigger goes on the stack. He says, I have a response to that. I've got Harnessed Lightning. I'm going to use up the 3 energy it gets plus one of the ones I have in my pool, targeting Archangel Avacyn and freeing up a lethal attack. That happens. And then before damage, Carlos Romao is going to activate Wandering Fumeral and go for a block.
To the Slaughter won't kill the Fumeral because Carlos can sacrifice the Knight ally. So this game isn't over this turn. If Carlos had gone for Negate, Shota could have finished things off. But Carlos wisely did not.
So smart play from Carlos Romao. To the Slaughter, thanks to that land, completing Delirium is going to take out a Planeswalker and a creature, but it's sacrifice, and Carlos gets to choose which one. So he only has one choice for Dovahnbaan, but he does have an extra choice with the creature, meaning that he gets to survive for the turn thanks to Dovahnbaan's plus ability from last turn.
So Carlos, his Wandering Fumeral, indestructible because he activated it in response to the Avacyn trigger.
Okay.
So that, got the block Awoken Horror. The Trenchful Gearhook did 2 damage because I got -3/-0 from Dovahnbaan. So Carlos falls to 3, still facing down 2 lethal threats. Shota still has Negate in hand. And you know Shota has Trenchful Gearhook in hand as well. So it's going to be very difficult for Carlos to get out of this.
Carlos is looking for a way, any way to scrap his way back into this game. He has nothing to give. If he loses this game, the Pro Tour is over and Shota Yasooka will be our champion. He's got to find something, and he's got to dig for it. It's going to be Glimmer of Genius.
Shota happy to let this resolve now, since he knows that any answer is going to involve Carlos playing a spell. He's going to be able to negate that spell.
Carlos desperately digging here. He's going to put 2 on the bottom.
He found an Immolating Glare.
He did.
The hope is still alive here. Carlos is fast approaching the territory where he's not going to be able to play around Shota having almost anything.
All right, passes the turn back to Yasooka. Shota draws his card for the turn as a thing in the ice. He's going to attack with both of his creatures. They're both lethal. Carlos has to deal with them. He's going to start off with Immolating Glare. Shota is going to negate it, and that's going to do it. Shota Yasooka is your Pro Tour Kaladesh champion. Now 2-time Pro Tour champion, Shota Yasooka, truly a master. As if we didn't know it before, he keeps on showing us. Congratulations, Shota Yasooka. You are allowed to smile now, my friend. I'll try to get him to smile when I talk to him on the award ceremony, but it's all business for him. He's just in the zone at all times, and he is our champion. There you go. Congratulations, Shota Yasooka. We can all breathe a little sigh of relief. Those are intense matches, especially between 2 excellent players like this, navigating through a tough control mirror, you know, the whole Drago thing for so many times, and really forced to understand what's important and what matters at each stage of those games. It can be very, very difficult, and it was really a pleasure to watch both Carlos Romao and our champion, Shota Yasooka, navigate through those games.
Oh, yeah. Matches of magic like that are what I live for, and it was really awesome getting to see Shota emerge victorious.
Yeah, it was really cool. When we came into the booth, you know, Luis and I were both like, all right, we got a good one here. And it's always like that when we get the certain types of matchups that tend to go like that because, you know, we knew already before we even got here. In the booth, that's exactly how that was going to play out. Fantastic stuff from the feature match area. That is going to do it for us in the booth here. So for Luis Scott Vargas, I'm Marshall Sutcliffe. Let's send it back to the news desk in Rich Hagen.
Thanks very much to Marshall Sutcliffe and Luis Scott Vargas with the call of the final of Pro Tour Kaladesh. Rich, BDM, Ian here with you. We're going to head towards the award ceremony. You'll see that live. Then we'll have curtain call. We'll wrap up everything from the weekend. But let's start with that final. Ian, what a great match to close it out.
Yeah, just beautiful to watch. I mean, control and control finals for those of us who've been playing Magic for a long time and just love that kind of counter Magic, you know, back and forth, maneuvering game plans, you know, tapping out your opponent so you can resolve a threat. It's just awesome.
You said countering stuff kind of game, and I thought you were going to say count your library style of game, which, you know, it sounds so weird that that's exciting, but watching players play it at that crisp pace and know instantly when the corner turned, they're like, uh-oh,
this could
come down to decade. And we saw all of the games that Shota won get done in completely different ways, completely dependent on where the 2 players were intersecting with each other. You know, there was a game where he was going to get decked, and he just sat there with a Torrential Gearhulk, knowing full well that an Immolating Glare was sitting potentially, he didn't even know it was there, but potentially sitting in hand of Carlos Romao, and he just waited and waited and waited and waited until he could finally just send everything in, including all his wandering criminals. It was a great game. And then ran Carlos Romao, effectively ran him out of cards in game two.
Not for the first time in Magic history, patience turns out to be a virtue. Just a fantastic final. If you are just joining us, of course, you'll be able to follow the whole story of the day. We'll show you everything all over again at twitch.tv/magic. But while we have a few minutes, as we await the award summary, let's walk you through what did actually happen here today, because it was our new top eight style bracket with 5 through 8 starting off in the first stage of the quarterfinals. And this saw Carlos Romao against Joey Manna. Ian, what happened in the Romao Manna match?
Yeah, before the match, you know, having talked to Carlos Romao, he actually said he thought he was a little bit of a not a favorite in the matchup and was kind of concerned about it. But Carlos actually ended up pulling things through and won that match. I believe it was 3-1.
Three to one. That's yeah. Right. And then BDM Ben Hull with his red-white vehicles deck. He was a first timer, both in the top eight and in the tournament. 34-year-old from Canada, up against Li Shi Chan Mardu vehicles. So what happened there?
It turns out that the new model of vehicles still had a couple kinks to work out. There was a factory recall, and Ben Hull advanced to the next stage of the quarterfinals, playing the last year's model. Red-white vehicles deck that, you know, we saw as the beginning of this new standard season in some of the open events.
Right, Chris Van Meter won the initial one with that. Yeah. So then that meant that in the second stage of quarterfinals, the 3 and the 4 seed came to join the party. That meant Pierre Dagenon of France with Blue Red Spells, Matt Nass with Team at Etherworks. Ian, Carlos Romao against Matt Nass didn't look good for Matt Nass.
Yeah, speaking of malfunctioning machinery that had to be recalled there, Matt Nass, you know, although he had a great tear through the Swiss, really, you know, showcasing this new teamer Aetherworks Marvel deck, it did not perform very well. Carlos Romao, with his counter magic, was able to win that match 3-0 against Matt Nass.
Yeah. Specifically, Spell Quellers played a really big factor in that game after sideboard.
And BDM, Matt Nass knew.
Yes, he
told anyone who would listen this morning, not just as a defense mechanism, but as an honest to goodness, I've looked at the matchup, basically can't win against either of them.
Yeah, I mean, your whole deck ends up revolving around a 4-mana artifact that can be negated, can be, you know, there are any number of different narrow counterspells all intersect at the corner of Etherworks and Marvel.
Absolutely true, and I think that's a big part of the reason we saw so much blue in the top eight here, in blue control specifically, is because those counter spells are absolutely crucial against that Etherworks Marvel deck.
In the bottom part of the bracket, it was the first appearance of Pierre Dagenon of France with blue red spells. And I've got to be honest, in a way, I think this was the most disappointing of the matches today. Great job by Ben Hull to win 3-0. But I really like Pierre Dagenon's Blue Red Spells deck. And I do encourage you at home, do go and play it. It's a lot better than that matchup Ian made it look.
Yeah, totally agree. Dynavolt Tower, you know, the key card in the matchup, a card I love to see on camera, and really well positioned here this weekend for taking out red-white vehicles, perfectly matches up against Smuggler's Copter. Unfortunately, did not work out for Pierre Dagenon, and Ben Hull managed to power through into the semifinals.
So at that point, BDM, we'd seen 5 through 8. We'd added in 3 and 4. We'd also got rid of 3 and 4. Could the last people who hadn't yet played do any better? It was Makis Matsoukas of Greece, the number one seed, and Shota Yasooka, the number two, with Grixis Control. So Romao took on Makis Matsoukas in the semifinal. How did that go, BDM?
Well, you know what? Makis Matsoukas was waiting a long time to get to play Magic after being the number one seed yesterday. But Carlos Romao has been waiting a long time to get back to this stage. And he made the most of that opportunity, and Carlos Romao was able to sweep his board and deal with his creatures and just kind of pick things off and never let Matsoukas get much footing in the match. He did get one game, but it was 3-1 in favor of Carlos Romao. Matsoukas playing in his first Pro Tour, and just an incredible, incredible accomplishment for him and the entire Greek Magic community.
Yeah, and Ian, it's great that, I'm sure that Makis will say, you know, a loss is a loss, but I'm also sure that when he gets home, at least he has won a game in the top eight, and that's more than most of us will ever be able to say.
Absolutely true, and it can't be overstated just how much of an accomplishment it is in his first Pro Tour to make it all the way through to the top eight, especially as top seed in the Swiss.
And I'll really take away the words he said to me as he left the venue today.
Right.
See you in Dublin.
Yeah, there we go.
That's a great attitude to have. I love it.
Fantastic stuff. So that meant that Makis Matsoukas was gone, but there was still someone playing in their first Pro Tour who could win their very first Pro Tour. That was Ben Hull with red-white vehicles. But having beaten Li Shichan with five Pro Tour top eights, having beaten Pierre Dajon, a Pro Tour finalist from Theros in 2013, he came up against Shota Yasooka. BDM, he was an underdog just on name recognition and skill and experience. But how did the matchup play out?
Well, you know what? I think this is one of the decks that Shota Yasooka had squarely in mind when he built his deck, which had, you know, this great combination of board sweepers, spot removal, and just inevitable grinding control of the game with Torrential Gearhulk for whichever of those cards you needed to get a second use out of later in the game.
Absolutely true. And the other card that really stood out to me as being particularly well positioned in that matchup, Thing in the Ice.
Just
been a tremendous asset for Shota all weekend long. Really excels against that red-white vehicles deck, which is trying to just flood the board with lots of permanents. If you can catch those vehicles when they're crude, they also get sent
back. We sent some guys over in a couple of helicopters to go look at this thing that's been pulled into the dock, and oh no.
Helicopter down.
So it was Shota Yasooka who advanced to the final, and something that stuck with me from the final that Marshall said during commentary. He said, one of the things I love about the control decks is that sometimes they, in history, control decks have assumed control of the game and then they've nibbled away with a 1-1 or an Ophidian or some very small creature that over 10 to 12 turns finally makes you dead. But here, you had Thing in the Ice for Shota being utterly enormous, and you had Torrential Gearhulk for Carlos Romao being utterly enormous, and they really, BDM, closed the games out in a hurry.
Yeah, absolutely, but, you know, it sort of, because we did see, like, I mean, Shota Yasooka also playing Torrential Gearhulk, again, had that Gearhulk in play, and he's like, oh, wait a minute. Remember the, you have Immolating Glare in hand. I'm pretty sure I'm just going to leave this here until I absolutely need it and can pick a fight that I can win. And so, you know, it was just amazing magic to watch. And I feel like you could have watched the same exact sequence of turns with almost any two other players on the Pro Tour, and that match would have taken hours longer.
Yeah, very true. Very, very decision-intensive game, but masterfully played by both players, and it was just fantastic to watch.
One of the themes, Ian, we've seen this weekend is just how versatile New Standard is, and we've seen lots of different decks. But what seemed so great to me was that even in the final, you got four incredibly different games of Magic.
Yeah, very true. You know, really showcased the diversity of Standard here with Kaladesh. I think it's been a breath of fresh air for all of us, especially seeing a control-on-control matchup in the final following social media. A lot of people seem to be really pleased to see that change of events compared to last Standard.
All right. Well, they gave us a great final. It's time to honor the finalist and the champion. It's time for the award ceremony here at Pro Tour Kaladesh.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the feature match area here at Pro Tour Kaladesh. It was a super exciting tournament, and what a finals we had. It is time to recognize our champion. From Japan, Shota Yasooka. And as always, we get a chance to have a little chat with our winner here, Shota. You already have your name on this trophy, and now you're going to have it on there twice. What a great accomplishment.
Yeah,
this is my individual, so very happy.
Yeah, I would be too. Now, one other question. Do you want to say thank you or acknowledge anybody that helped you get to this point of being a two-time Pro Tour champion?
The fans and the people who supported him.
All right, his fans and the people who supported him. We have a bunch of them here. Congratulations once again to our champion, Shota Yasooka. We'll be right back.
Yeah. We still do an interview after, but we need him to stay here.